Hello, and welcome to This Is My Architecture. I'm Joe. I'm joined here today with Steve from INT. How are you doing?
Great. I'm glad to be here.
That's great. So we appreciate you coming in. Can you talk to us a little about INT and what you guys do there?
Sure. INT is a software company that we build visualization for geoscience data. And we'll be talking today about our main flagship, which is IVAAP.
Great. It definitely, seismic data is always something that is very important in, geographic surveys and oil and gas. So, can you walk us through kind of the first entry point into your IVAAP solution?
Sure. So IVAAP is a client-server application. So we've got code running in the browser and also in the server. So the very first step is to get logged into the system because this is all sensitive data. So all of the access is, definitely locked down, controlled. So the first thing you're going to do is do a login, which is going to go, the request is going to go through our main IVAAP reverse proxy, and then go down into user management, and which is backed by Amazon Cognito in this case.
Okay, great. So Cognito, I'm assuming you have to set up these accounts, the users, the roles. How do you manage that for a customer basis?
That's very simple. We don't. We let the customer or our partner like Amazon deal with that.
Okay. Yeah. And then from a service endpoint, are you leveraging Cognito for service authorization as well?
No, we have a component that's running here on the EC2 instance that is a Node.js instance. Okay, that then talks to a Postgres instance. In this case, it's running on Amazon RDS. And we use that to store project configuration. So when a user gets started, they'll configure a project with particular data sources and also set up access control rights. And this also keeps track of what users have access to what.
Almost like groups and policies around the groups.
Yeah, exactly. It's a role-based access control.
Great. Okay. Walk us through this OSDU and how do you leverage OSDU and what is OSDU?
So OSDU is a consortium that builds out a set of APIs that let you remotely access your geoscience data.
Okay.
So from IVAAP's perspective, OSDU is a data source. It's one of many data sources that we support. So the way we do that is we have a series of adapters. And so we'll have a particular adapter that will talk to OSDU. So our architecture in the back end is a microservice architecture. So each one of these adapters is a microservice. And we have, of course, very many other ones that talk to a whole lot of other different data sources. But in this case for today, we'll just be talking about OSDU.
Okay, great. Are these custom built adapters or are these AWS services? How did you build those?
These adapters are definitely custom built by INT. And so the cool thing is that the client doesn't have to know anything about which adapters are running. The microservices just tell the client what data is available, and the client doesn't have to care even which adapter is which or anything.
Great. I'm assuming OSDU is going to have a lot of data. So
that's right.
Just assuming that, talk to me about how you guys are managing the performance and the throughput of data.
Well, I think it's best to talk about that in the context of the seismic data.
Okay.
So the seismic data is when you have this is active reflection seismic data. So this is where you have an active source, like in water you would have an air gun that just goes sort of burp, 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 sending out sound and seismic out into the ground. It reflects off of the rock layers under the ground, back up into sensors, and the sensors measure. And so each sensor is measuring what we call a trace, and that's about 1,500 samples for each trace. The data sets for seismic are just huge. Like a large data set is maybe, say, a terabyte. A very large one could be a petabyte, and that's for a single data set.
Wow.
So the way that we manage this is to begin with, is the client, they first need to do a search to find what data they want to look for. So that goes through the EC2 and up through our adapter and over to OSU for their search. And that's backed by Elasticsearch, and it handles lots of files. Once they get the results back and look at them, they'll make a display. And so then the first step to building the display is to know which traces it is that you want to look at. So to build the display, you're probably only going to need maybe 200 or 300 traces. So that's maybe 10 or 15K worth of data. So that's a lot smaller than a terabyte. So that's the first thing that's done is the selection of which data you need to paint the pixels.
Right.
And that's super critical. So we'll make the request up here, which goes to the adapter. Then the adapter is going to need to access the data in S3, but to do that, in the adapter, we need to compute the byte offsets into the data set because the traces are not necessarily in order. They might be out of order, and the data set might be irregular. So we have indexes, an index for each of the keys, and we combine that, and combining that gives us the unique offset for each trace.
Wow. It sounds like a very complex orchestration, technologies you've leveraged.
Yes, it is.
And it sounds like a really good solution.
It is, and the part that's really great is the way it matches up with S3, because these data sets are just huge, and so when it's uploaded, S3 is not like just a single thing. It's this whole distributed network, and so when we're asking for the traces, we actually do the requests. Most of the time, we have to do them in parallel, because the traces are skipping around in the data set.
So parallel querying, parallel searches through S3, providing you performance.
That's right.
Outstanding. I love that.
And S3 really stands up to that kind of level of just hammering on it.
Great.
It's really great.
Great.
So then as the request comes back, we have we compress the data. We have some native code that runs there that's using AVX extension instructions that are vector instructions. So we get about a 6x speed up on the compression code. And we're able to compress the data that's coming back about like anywhere between 4 to 13 times. And then finally it gets back to the client. We decompress it using WebAssembly, and then we build up this display. And the display is built up on top of an HTML5 canvas element.
Great. Sounds like a great solution for our customers. I do appreciate you showing this to us. It's a great option with leveraging AWS, as well as custom-built solutions that you've put into this as well.
Well, thank you.
I do appreciate you coming in and talking about it.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching This Is My Architecture.